For his praise shall continually be in my mouth, for there is none like him. I love him so much, and I love him for the Sabbath, a day when the presence of the Lord zooms in. I am not saying that in other days it doesn't zoom in. It's always there, but it's heightened on the Sabbath. And so because of that, allow me to say it's a happy Sabbath. I want to thank God for allowing us to see yet another day. Our message for this evening, as you have seen, is Behold the Man. Matthew chapter 13, verse number 16 and 17. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For verily I say unto you, that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which you see, but never saw them, and to hear the very things that you are hearing, but they never heard them. Kind and loving Father in heaven, we want to thank you this evening as we share your word, as we interact with the sacred pages. May you take us to the throne above, and may the word that shall come out of your mouth fulfill that which is your intention. Like the dew upon the earth, may it yield fruit in Jesus' name is our prayer. Amen. Our text, as you have heard, is John chapter 19, verse number 5. So Jesus came out wearing a crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate said to them, Behold the man. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. There are four important elements that I would love to talk about. The first one is that Jesus came out. I am glad because Jesus came out. When you come out, it means you have gone in. Hello? Yeah, so Jesus came out because he had gone in. He came out, and outside were the Jewish rabbis, the Pharisees, and all those people that used to have arguments against each other, but at this time they are united in the cause of evil. They are in an evil contract. Now, because they are in an evil contract, they come together and they say, let us make a plan to make sure that this is the end of the life of this man. But now, listen very carefully, they don't get in to where Pilate is, because according to the Jewish custom, they knew that they were going to defile themselves. But I love Jesus because he got in there. He went in there because he was the Paschal Lamb, the Passover Lamb. He was not going to be defiled, because in him was my sin, in him was my suffering, in him was my pain. So he got into a place where the Jews said, if we go in there, we will not be able to participate in the Passover. But the Passover Lamb managed to get in there, because he was the ultimate sacrifice that the Lord had called. When he got in there, the Bible tells us that Pilate took Jesus and scourged him, and the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head, the Bible says, and a purple robe, and they said, Hail King Jesus! And they smote him with their hands. And Pilate therefore went forth, he went out again, verse 4 of chapter number 5, and said unto them, Behold, I bring him forth, because he had gone in, I bring him forth, that ye may know that I find no fault in him. So Pilate had been struggling. When you read the previous chapters, you will discover that he had asked, what is the truth? Yet the truth was standing right in front of him. Jesus Christ himself was standing, and he turned to the people and said, what shall I do? He was supposed to ask. The answer was standing right in front of him. I love Jesus because he came out. When he came out to fulfill the plan of redemption. When he came out, as the Passover lamb. Who is this man that came out? In Genesis, we are told there is a promise that is given to Adam when he had sinned, that he is the seed of the woman that shall bruise the serpent's head. He is going to bruise the serpent's head, not by crushing it, but by crushing his own life. So now when he comes out, he is preparing himself to be crushed so that he could crush the serpent's head. I don't know whether I have church folk in this place. When he came out ready to be crucified, the devil thought he had got his prey, but it was him who was the prey of the cross. He was going to be crushed by the cross at that point in time. So I am glad he came out, that seed of the woman that shall bruise the serpent's head. I am glad he came out, that rose of Sharon. I am glad he came out, that bread of life. I am glad he came out, the bright and morning star. I am glad Jesus came out, the lily of the valley. I am glad Jesus came out, Michael the archangel. I am glad he came out. But when he came out wearing a crown of thorns. He came out wearing a crown of thorns. He wore that crown of thorns. We may never have to travel that road to Calvary. We may never have to carry that old rugged cross. For 2,000 years ago, he planted a tree and gave it rain and gave it sunshine because he knew that that tree would become the old rugged cross. He made a man grow up, and he knew that that man would become the man that would carry the nails that would pierce his hands. Yes, he allowed that man to eat, live, and survive all the cancers of that time. When he knew that that man is going to be the one that will say, I execute you to eternal damnation. But he didn't know that he is working out a plan of redemption. So when Jesus came out, it was good news. Wearing a crown of thorns, he took the place that was ours, the servant of the Lord says, so that we could take the place that was his. He suffered the pain that was ours so that we could participate in the glory that was his. And so I say, all praise be to God, for he came out and wore a crown of thorns. He not only wore a crown of thorns, he had a purple robe. This was a kind of a mockery to say he is the king. But deeper than the mockery, Pilate had seen something that was different in this prisoner that had come. He had seen that he was meek and lowly, yet a man of high estate. Standing there as a judge, he knew that I could be the one that I am judged. His heart was softened by the love of God. And his wife told him that have nothing to do with this man because I did not sleep because of this man. So he says, I find no fault in him. So he took him out. Behold the man. Behold the man. When he took him out, that was Israel's last opportunity to behold the Lamb of God. It was not the first time when they were called to behold the Lamb of God. One day when John was baptizing in the river Jordan, and when people came on that morning, John lifted up his eyes and he saw, behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the earth. At this point in time, Pilate is reiterating the words of John the Baptist, who was no longer living at this point in time. He says, behold the man. There was silence demons rushed in and inspired the priests. Instead of saying, "We accept the man," they said, "Crucify him. Crucify him. Hang him on a tree and let him die." And I want to say to us this evening, behold, the man is standing right in front of you. What will be your decision when you behold the man? There are two things that happen to clay and wax when the same temperature is exposed. Wax melts and clay hardens. There are two types of Christians. When they behold the man every Sabbath, when they come to church, some will say, "Crucify him afresh." But I want to implore us today, tonight, to behold the man and turn our eyes on Jesus and look full on his wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. It all depends upon the spectacles that you are putting on. Because in that mob, there were people who looked with pity. Ellen White tells us that the soldiers, if they could, they were going to help. But they loved, they looked at this man with tender pitiness, with tender hearts, because they saw in this man something different. That is why the centurion on that night, he said, "This must be the Son of God." He spoke divine words that were inspired by the Holy Spirit to say, "This man must be the Son of God." He knew Jesus Christ. Behold the man. It depends on whether you know him or you know about him. If you know about him, he will be another story that we study about in the seminary. If you know about him, he will not be part of your experience. If you don't know about him, he will not be part of your experience. But if you know him, you walk and talk with him, and you hear his voice speaking in your heart. This is the way. Walk ye in it. Stories told of a woman who lived. There are some homes that are jails because the husband is something else. When he comes, he beats the son. He beats the wife, and the wife beats the son, and the son kicks the dog, and the dog goes after the cat, and the cat runs after the mouse. The home is a jail. So on this other day, anger grew to animosity, animosity to outbursts of shouting and the exchange of words that was unsanctified, until this man decided, "Let me end the life of this woman," picking a gun, pointing it to the wife, shot her dead, took the gun and pointed it to himself, shot himself dead. A little boy was there, saw all this mess, taken to a foster home, Christian home. His parents were atheists. Taken to a foster home, Christian home. The teacher in the Sabbath school was told by the foster parents of this little boy, "Be careful how you teach about the man Jesus Christ, because this boy never heard about Jesus Christ. Grew up in a home where the Bible is not magnified." So the teacher, in a way to introduce Jesus Christ, picked the picture of Jesus Christ. And he said, "Anyone who knows this man?" And the boy raised his right hand. The teacher, amazed, the boy with a voice that was marred with sadness and choked with grief, and tears began to stream down his eyes, and he said, I know this man. I know him. He held my hand that day when my parents died. Behold,